In this video, we're going to talk about the continuity of functions, and we will prove a theorem that will give us a characterization of different definitions for the continuity of functions. This will be useful to prove when a function is continuous or not, to have several definitions that are all equivalent. Remember that if you want to support the channel, you can do so in several ways. You can become a subscriber on Patreon to get access to exclusive content and mathematics merchandising. You can also make small donations on Ko-fi, or you can buy a t-shirt on our mathematics t-shirt store. Let's continue with the video. We have x and y, two topological spaces. This means that we have x with its own topology and y with its own topology, and a function from x to y. We say that this function is continuous if for every open set b in y, so in the codomain, the preimage of p through f is open in x. So a function is continuous if for every p in cell y, in the y topology, the preimage of p is an element in the x topology. Remember what the preimage was. So f minus 1 here is not necessarily the inverse. If the function admits an inverse, then the preimage will be the same as the inverse. But if it's not, then the preimage is just defined as the set of all the x in the domain, such that f of x is an element in B. So the idea is, if I grab an open set in Y and check the preimage, if for every set in tau Y, the preimage is in tau X, then the function is continuous. And this might sound weird, but it's actually the same definition that we have on the real line. Because in the real line, we say for every epsilon, there exists delta such that f of x minus delta, the interval x plus delta, is a subset of f of x minus epsilon, f of x plus epsilon. This is basically the definition of continuity that we are used to from calculus 1. So this definition of continuity, the new one, is more general than it will work for any two topological spaces. This is me actually while editing the video, and I realized that I didn't give you any examples of continuous or non-continuous functions. The first example one thinks always is just the identity function. I mean, the identity function is always continuous, right? Well, this is topology, so the things that are usually trivial are not always valid here. For this example, let's consider we have f that goes from the real numbers with the standard topology to the real numbers but with a lower limit topology. And f of x, all it does is takes an element and gives you the same number, because, well, these are just numbers, so f of 3 will be 3, f of 4 is 4, and so on. Now, we want to see if this function is continuous, and it suffices to show it with the basis elements. Just take a basis element in RL and see if the preimage of that basis element is in the standard topology. Well, for example, I can take 0, 1. 0, 1 is an element in the lower limit topology, and so let's see what happens. Well, the preimage of 0, 1, because f is the identity function, then this gives us the same set. So 0, 1 is open in RL, but the 0, 1, this other, is not open in the standard topology. This example is giving us a function that is not continuous, and, well, that function turns out to be the identity. So no, the identity isn't always continuous. It actually depends a lot on the topologies that we are considering. So now let's go back to the video. Now let's prove a theorem that will give us alternative definitions for continuity of functions. This is the theorem, and it says that all these things are equivalent. So basically, the second one will be useful whenever we're working with the closure of sets. The third one is something that we already talked about, it essentially is telling us that we could have defined the continuity of functions with closed sets. We knew that we could have done everything so far with closed sets and everything would have been the same. Well, nothing changes again with continuity of functions. The preimage of closed sets is closed if and only if the function is continuous. And then number four is more of a local definition, because we are now standing in a point x in the space and looking at the neighborhoods in the codomain of f of x, and we want to find a neighborhood of x in the domain such that the image of that set is contained in the other one. So this definition is a bit more local, and this is the definition that we will choose to say that a function f is continuous at a point x. So to prove this theorem, we're going to do two things. First, we will prove that 1 implies 2, 2 implies 3, and 3 implies 1. This would mean that 1, 2, and 3 are all equivalent. And then, separately, that 1 implies 4, and 4 implies 1. Then all four statements are equivalent. Let's start with the first one. Let's prove that 1 implies 2. If I have a continuous function, then the image of the closure is a subset of the closure of the image. So what I will want to prove is that if x is an element in the closure of A, then f of x is an element in the closure of f of A. So for this, let's take an element x in the closure of A. To prove that f of x is an element in the closure of f of a, we have to take a neighborhood of f of x and prove that the intersection with f of a is non-empty. Let P be a neighborhood, so let's assume we have a tau I topology, a neighborhood of f of x. B has f of x. Then because f is continuous, the preimage of P is open in x, and so this is an element in tau x. So again, this is because f is continuous. So this is an open set, and obviously the preimage of P has x. So because x is an element in the closure of A, and this is just some neighborhood of x, we have that there exists some element y in the intersection of this neighborhood with A. But then this implies that f of y is part of P intersection f of A. So then this intersection is non-empty for any neighborhood of f of x. And then this proves that f of x is an element in the closure of f of A, which is what we need. Now let's continue proving that 2 implies 3. We already have this one. So now we know that we have this relation with the image of the closure and the closure of the image. And we want to prove that the preimage of any closed set is also a closed set. So what we will do is take P, a closed set in Y, and let's call it, to make notation simpler, A to the preimage of P. We want to prove that this preimage is closed. So we want to prove that A is closed in X. And to prove this is the same as proving that A is equal to its closure. Now let's think of it about f of a. Well, f of a, using this definition, is f of the preimage of P. And this, given that we don't know anything about our function, gives us only an inclusion with P. And so what we can do is now take x in the closure of A. We want to prove that x is in A, because we already have this inclusion. To prove that x is in A is the same as proving that x is in the preimage of P, because the preimage of P is A. So we can prove that the image of x is in B. Well, what is the image of x? Well, x was an element in the the closure of A, so this is obviously an element in F of A bar. And because of our hypothesis, this is a subset of the closure of F of A. But from here, we get that this is a subset of the closure of B. But P was a closed set in Y, so the closure of P is equal to P. So then from this, we have that F of X is an element in B. So X is an element in the pre-image of P, which is A. And so this happens, which implies what we wanted to prove. So with this, we proved that 2 implies 3, and now we have to prove that 3 implies 1. So if we know that the pre-image of closed sets is closed, then we have to prove that the pre-image of open sets is open. So now that we want to see that the pre-image of open sets is open, let's take B, an open set in Y. So B is an element in the Y topology. And let's call B Y minus B. Because B is open, Y minus B is closed. So B is a closed set, and we know that the pre-image of closed sets is closed. So let's see what this pre-image is. We know that this one will be closed. This is from our hypothesis, but this is also the pre-image of Y minus the pre-image of B. Now the pre-image of Y is obviously X, and then we have the pre-image of B. So this is a closed set, but then X minus some set is closed means that this set has to be open, and this is exactly what we wanted to prove. The pre-image of an open set is open. So with this, we finished proving all this chain, and now we have to prove that 1 implies 4 and 4 implies 1. Remember that 4 was the local continuity, so given X and given a neighborhood of F of X, we have to find a neighborhood U of X such that F of U is contained in B. But now this one is going to be very simple. Just take an element, and B in the Y topology that contains f of x. So B is a neighborhood in Y of f of x. Because f is continuous, the pre-image of open sets is open. And obviously this pre-image contains x. So this is a new set, let's call it U, in X, that's a neighborhood of X. And that is exactly what we had to prove. Now let's see that 4 implies 1. So now we have to prove that the pre-image of open sets is also an open set. So let's take B in the Y topology. We want to prove that the pre-image of B is open. So for each X in B, we know that there exists a set UX in the X topology such that F of UX is contained in B. Now we can write the pre-image of B as the union for all X in B of all these UX, because UX here will be contained in the pre-image of B. These are all open sets. And then the arbitrary union of open sets is also open. And this proves exactly what we wanted. With this, we finish this video about the continuity of functions.